Welcome to part 3 of the Kenwood KR6170 series. In the first episode, I unboxed this new old stock receiver and introduced you to all its crazy gadgets. Kenwood called it the Jumbo because it's huge in size and on features: a drum machine, spring reverb, mic inputs, guitar inputs, and timer, just to name a few. In part 2, I gave you a tour of the inside of the KR6170, tested some transistors and capacitors, temporarily fixed the DC on the speaker outputs, demonstrated the drum machine and microphone, and discovered that the FM tuner is dead. If you missed those episodes, I'll leave links in the description. Okay, so we need to now diagnose and fix the dead FM. Imagine you only have three tools at your disposal: a $1,500 oscilloscope, a $500 multimeter, and a $15 can of contact cleaner. Which would you choose first? Me? I'm going with the contact cleaner. Let's spray some in the selector switch and really work it in good. All right, I've cleaned out the selector switch. Let's see if we got lucky and that fixes our problem. Let's power the unit on. Turn up our volume. Oh, okay. I hear static. Okay, good sign. We seem to have fixed our FM problem just by cleaning out the selector switch. Let's go through the band, see if we can pick up any stations. Not much. Again, I do have an antenna hooked up, but I'm down in the basement. Very little action. Okay, I have an idea. I have a little gadget that just might help. Be right back. Okay, say hello to my little friend. This is the Magnum Sleuth FM Power Tunable Antenna Amplifier. This is a vintage unit, goes back to the 70s. I picked it up a while ago. And it really can help down here in the basement to not only tune in the FM stations, but to also amplify and boost the signal. So the way this works is you plug your antenna into this device and the output goes into your tuner or receiver. And depending on the station that you want, you can tune it in here. So if I wanted a station at, say, 96.1 FM, I would tune it approximately to there. And additionally, it has an amplifier, so it helps boost the gain of the FM signal. And you do that with this control here. So we have a strong station here at about 96.1 FM. Let's try tuning that in now using the Magnum Sleuth. Turn up our volume. Okay, the station should be right around there. Let me turn up the gain.
And it can stop a catastrophic leak with a simple... Water designs our life. Who designs for water? The water.
There you go. So you can see that using this Magnum Sleuth down here in the basement really does make a big difference for receiving FM.
Ed and say that he is He-Man. Listen to How Did We Get Weird with Vanessa and...
Okay, so that's basically with no amplification.
Is sponsored by Staples Store.
Big difference.
Staples Connect has innovative tools for small...
Let's try some other stations.
Select PCs like the Lenovo.
There you go. So again, you can see how much tuning the antenna also makes a big difference. Let's turn down the gain. And the signal disappears.
Rebecca Paris, a tune called It's You from Rutgers 1993.
Let's try the other end of the dial. Should be some stations around here. Okay, there you go. The FM appears to be working fine in this receiver. It may not even need an FM alignment. It's probably good from the factory. At this point, I want to permanently replace the audio coupling capacitors on the output. And also want to take a look at the filter capacitors as well. Let's see if we need to replace those. I might just replace them just for reliability's sake as we move forward. Now, this receiver is chock full of electrolytics, the smaller ones. But the unit appears to be working fine. I really don't want to do a full recap on this unit. I don't think I'm going to use it very often, and it works rather well. Once we replace the filter capacitors and the output capacitors, we'll do a battery of tests on this thing and see how it's performing. If we have any major issues, then we can look at improving things perhaps by doing an alignment or adjusting the bias, and perhaps by replacing some capacitors or some other parts. Let's dig in. Kenwood wisely added these braces to keep the jumbo receiver from twisting like a bad convertible. They're in the way right now, though, so let's temporarily remove one. Great, now we can access the bottoms of the four large filter and output capacitors. Let's remove the two remaining ones and another medium-sized capacitor that's also in the area. Let's now test the three capacitors we just removed. This device will check for capacitance and ESR, which is equivalent series resistance. The Heathkit IT28 will test for leakage or parallel resistance. And we'll use the multimeter to make sure the capacitors are discharged. This is especially important before hooking this up to the ESR meter, which can't tolerate much voltage on the capacitors. Okay, virtually no voltage on that cap, so that one's safe to proceed with. Let's check the 3300 microfarad 80 volt cap. Less than 0.15 volts, so it's safe to proceed with this capacitor as well. Now let's check the 50 volt 2200. And here we have, less than a tenth of a volt. So safe to proceed with all of these capacitors. Let's check for ESR first. Here we go. Okay, it's saying our 470 microfarad capacitor is coming in at 551. Not bad, really. And the ESR is 0.1 ohms. Very good. As far as ESR, this capacitor is fine. Let's set this one aside. Let's check the 2200 microfarad capacitor now. And with this tester, it doesn't matter which way you connect the leads. It will auto-detect the positive or negative. And here we can see our 2200 microfarad is coming in at about 2488 microfarad. That's just fine. And a very low ESR of 0.06 ohms. Excellent. Let's test the 3300 microfarad capacitor now for ESR. We've got a capacitance of 3748 microfarad, not too bad for a 3300 microfarad capacitor, and again, a very low ESR of 0.04 ohms. All three caps are just fine as far as ESR goes. Let's now check them for leakage, parallel leakage. Now, this device will test the capacitors under their working voltage load. So it'll put 80 volts through for this 80 volt capacitor, and 50 volts for the 50 volt capacitor, and 25 volts for the 25 volt capacitor. Let's start with our little guy here, 25 volts at 470 microfarad. Okay, I'm going to put this into leakage now, and we're looking for this eye to stay open at the working voltage of 25 volts. Let's ramp it up. We're on 3 volts now. That's 6 volts. Eye still open, good sign. 10 volts, eye is still open, 15, just fine, and at 25, you can see it closes a little bit and then starts opening again. This capacitor is just fine, the ESR was fine, and there is no parallel leakage. Let's check the 2200 microfarad capacitor now. Now this 2200 microfarad 50 volt capacitor is the same exact type of capacitor that we saw on the audio output section where there was significant leakage and we definitely needed to replace those. But note that this capacitor has been used in the filter section and significantly more current and voltage has been passing through this capacitor, which could likely reform this. And when we did the demonstrations, I really didn't hear much hum coming from the receiver. So this capacitor could be fine. It may have reformed itself. Let's give it a try here. Again, we need to check this all the way up to 50 volts. Put this on leakage. We're on 3, 6, 10, 15, 25. Okay, you see here we have it's closed. Let's see if it opens up. Okay, still not quite opened all the way. Let's go to 50. Yeah, actually seeing similar performance to the two capacitors that were in the audio output section. This may open over time, the eye may open, but I don't like what I see here. It's a new capacitor would perform much, much better than this, so this guy needs to be replaced. Okay, not even gonna wait. Let's discharge that one. Now notice that in discharge, when the eye opens, it means that the voltage has been discharged from the capacitor. So it's actually still not safe to touch. There's 50 volts on there or so. And there we go. Okay, the eye is open and now we can safely disconnect our leads. Not so much of a concern at 50 volts, but this tester will test all the way up to 600 volts. So you really want to make sure that the capacitor is completely discharged when you're working with those types of voltages. All right, and finally, let's test the 3300 microfarad capacitor, also used in the power filter section. Let's make sure we put our voltage down to 3. Okay, so this capacitor is rated up to 80 volts, so we really need to test it at 80 volts. Now, the Heathkit capacitor checker only goes from 50 to 100 volts, so we can see if it works at 50, and if it's still performing well at 50, I might just crank it to 100 to see if the eye closes. But it may not, based on the last capacitor's performance, it may not even open up at 50. So here we go. Let's put it on leakage. That's 3 volts. 6 volts, 10 volts, eye is opening, good sign, 15, 25. Okay, now we're seeing the eye is closed. Let's see if it opens up at all at 25. So because the eye is closed now, that's indicating that currently it is allowing DC to pass. But as the eye opens, it is allowing less DC to pass. All right, let's turn it up to 50. Now, again, we could wait, allow this capacitor to reform. But I'm telling you guys, a new capacitor isn't going to perform like this. Right out of the box, you're going to be able to go up to the rated voltage, and that eye is going to close within a second or two. So we're not even up to the rated voltage. Again, rated for 80 volts. We're only on 50. This eye is not opening. Another capacitor that needs to be replaced. So of the three capacitors, our little guy here did the best, and the two larger ones need replacement. So for the capacitors of this size, I may elect to just leave them in and not replace them at this point. And if we have any troubles with the performance of the receiver, we can go back and look at them. Okay, and as I've been speaking, we can see that at 50 volts, this capacitor is starting to open up on the eye. But again, a new capacitor would perform much better than that. Again, also, we're only at 50 volts. Let's quickly go to 100 volts and see what happens. Yeah. All right, I don't want to keep it on there very long because it's not even rated for 100 volts. Again, it's okay. This capacitor is okay, but not performing as new. It's going to go. To replace three of the larger caps, I'm going to try these adapter caps for the first time. These are really intended to help replace multi-section capacitors with up to 4 discrete ones, but in this case, I'm going to just use one per board. They'll fit in like this and should make for a nice clean install on this project. Let's give it a try. First, let's remove the two caps I temporarily installed for testing, and now let's install and wire everything up permanently. I'm also going to replace all of the other capacitors in this area since I'm in the neighborhood. I only had 3 adapter caps on hand, so I'll have to use a terminal strip for the 4th large capacitor. The terminal strip legs don't quite line up with the chassis holes, so to fix that, I'll open up one of the leg holes, install that side with a washer, and solder it to the chassis to keep everything firmly in place. Now I'll fold down 2 of the terminals to make a solid base for the capacitor, and trim off the others. Great, let's solder everything into place. Our work looks good from bottom to top. One of the most interesting things about this receiver is that it has an input jack for an electric guitar. So you can use it as a practice amp along with the microphone input and the reverb, and with that you can play along to the drum machine or any other input, whether it be a record or the AM or FM radio. I suppose you could use it on stage too, but this thing really isn't built for that. If I can get the receiver working well though, I do plan on asking some of my musician friends to do a little performance on this thing, so stay tuned for that in upcoming episodes. But the truth is, at this point, I haven't actually tested the guitar input, so let's do that now. And to do that, I'm going to use a signal generator to input a signal into one of the two guitar input jacks. Now, I'm actually a little nervous to plug into these jacks because there's no level control for the guitar inputs. And as soon as I plug in, this amp is going to go full gain. I won't be able to control it with the volume control. Unlike with the microphone input, where the Kenwood gives you a front panel level control, Kenwood expects you to control the guitar volume with the potentiometer on the guitar itself. And that means if there's any noise on our input cable or somewhere else in the input section, this thing could get really loud. Let's give it a shot. I'll just press the 50 watt power limiter just in case. And before I power on the unit, let's input our cable. I've got the signal generator connected to a quarter inch jack. I'm not a musician, so I don't have a guitar around. This is gonna have to do for now. And that'll go here. Okay, let's power things up and see what happens. Okay, it sounds like a day at the beach, and I don't mean that in a good way. Do you hear all that hissing? Now, at full gain, I expected to hear a little bit of buzz, but the hissing, that's an indicator perhaps of some bad transistors. Let's turn up the amplitude on the signal generator and see if we're passing a signal. I can very, very lightly hear the signal in the background, so I do think it is amplifying fine. Here we go. Okay, there we go. And you can hear how much gain we have, even with just 1 millivolt of input. And this incredible gain is necessary, of course, because a guitar pickup puts out a very, very tiny amount of voltage. So from what I'm hearing, the guitar input appears to be working fine, but we have a lot of noise. Now, I'm thinking that that probably indicates that we have some noisy transistors on the guitar preamp board. But I want to know what you think. Is this a transistor issue, or is something else going on? Do you have any experience with this that you'd like to share with me? Let me know in the comments. I'd be glad to hear from you. And in the next episode, I'll dive in and see if I can't get this noise under control. Stay tuned. I'll see you then.
Looking for a shiny new gadget for your bench? Some good books on electronics, vintage hi-fi or old radios? Indispensable tools, cleaners or other products? Check out my new Amazon shop and help the channel. Lots of great products I actually own, use, and recommend. Plus my thoughts on each one. Link in the description. To stay updated, please subscribe to my channel and click the bell to receive notifications when I release new videos. And if you like this video, give it a thumbs up. I'll see you soon.